Welcome to the Huawei Product and Solution Launch about 5G here in London. And I have the pleasure and honor to be with Paul Scanlan. You're the CTO for the Carrier Business Group from Huawei. And we had a series of presentations about 5G. And it's going to beyond any imagination, I think. We had 2019, the first rollout. Now we go to 2020. Can you share what we can expect?
Sure. You know, I think maybe I paraphrase a little bit about what our CEO just mentioned. And he said, you know, in October of last year, so October 2019, and he said he's very aggressive, yeah? And he always says, you know, I predicted $300 handset, 5G handset, by fourth quarter of 2020. And he stood on stage and said, I'm actually wrong, right? It's actually happened last year, happened a year earlier than he expected. Yeah. So why? Why are those sorts of things? And it's not just that the product from a consumer is ready, but the ecosystem is ready. So I like to think of, you know, last time we chatted, and it was sort of, you know, 2017, I made a comment, I made mention to you last time we chatted, I said that in 2017 is when the standards were frozen, yes, or the first standardization existed in November. And in February, Huawei launched end-to-end. So 1 year ago, we launched end-to-end, but you know, the product was this big, it was a bit heavy for the CPE, it cost a lot of money, those sorts of things. The base station was this big, even though we're innovative, 45 kilos, 40 kilos, etc. And operators were sort of thinking, oh, it's a bit expensive, how to launch it, what's the business model? Yeah? So there's sort of three things. So now, 1 year asking, what's happened? So the first one is that the products, the consumer products have become smaller, lighter, cheaper, faster. Mm-hmm. That's very important. The second thing you have is that operators understood the business model, and that is, I need to satisfy growth, and 5G is great for growth. Mm-hmm. And everybody's consuming video, and 5G is great for video, so I should build 5G. It's cheaper, more efficient, and serves my customers. Mm-hmm. So you've got the consumer, but you've got the telecom operator. Perhaps the most important thing is that the industries are understanding that 5G can transform them. And the telecom operators are starting to understand that they're an intrinsic part of this transformation program. And what we tried to show today was, you know, the products that are going to support, I'll say, this year and the following year's future. Mm-hmm.
And you were addressing already the business models are going to change, are capable to change with 5G, maybe in different industries. Can you elaborate on that?
Sure. So let's have a think about how we sell services today. So services today, it's based on a simple operating model. I buy a license for £1 billion. I build a network for £500 million. I put a base stations and I sell SIMs, okay, and consumers. So that's a very B2C business model. It's pretty simple. I have one, more or less one product. I know the operators are going to be terribly upset with me, but I'm simplifying things for your audience. But as we now move beyond that and we start moving into the industrialized areas, yes, of these things, you have to do things in a different way. So it's not about building a 5G tower or cell site or base station. It's about if you want to transform a manufacturing plant, you have to put small cells inside the manufacturing plant. Yeah. It's a bit like, where's the traffic? The traffic is indoors, not outdoors. And a lot of the 5G use cases, whether they are on VR or AR, that's mostly indoor application. You're not going to have a guy with a camera with 5G VR glasses riding outside in the mountains, right? That's going to take a little bit of time, yeah? So it's a lot of it is indoor. So that means that we need to improve the indoor experience. If you want VR AR, it's generally indoor. It's either for training or for education or, for training or for entertainment value. Uh-huh. So when we move to some of the industrial applications like 5G in a factory, why did we pick manufacturing? You know, yes, it's a very big industry, but it's because that industry, they understand their problems. Their problems are they use Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, this sort of local area type stuff for connectivity, and they found that they are not acceptable. 5G will provide a lot less latency. Mm-hmm. It's not about the bandwidth in these cases, though some of it requires video, and that's a video uplink, which is terribly important. But the target is massive connections, inexpensive, very, very reliable connectivity for the robots. Why? Improve predictive maintenance. Improving predictive maintenance by about 1%, you get about $100 to $200 billion of improvements across the globe. That's a good reason, yeah? That saves cost to the planet, and then we move downstream. If you take, say, the next best industry, which is probably health is terribly complex, very complicated, complex and complicated. It's difficult to do and to transform and to change. You know, it's a very traditional sort of enterprise, yes, or industry. If you want a connected ambulance, how are you going to do that? You know, most of the roads, even in the UK, you get a dropped call. I don't mean disrespect to the operators. They do a very good job.
Yeah.
but the KPIs are different, right? It's you want a license, pay me $1 billion and 95% coverage in 3 years. Now you say, I want all the roads connected with this low latency, high speed, so an ambulance can have sophisticated equipment in and save lives. Of course we want that. But the challenge is there.
And one important topic, I think, which not many people talk about, but I think it's one of the key values, is the social value of 5G, yes. From end-to-end 5G. Yeah. Can you explain it? Because I don't think many people understand this if you just talk about it like
sure,
this.
Sure, sure. So I touch a little bit on the health, and I'll come back to that mm-hmm. one. But let's talk about another one, because you know that probably the hottest topic, other than Huawei in the news every day, is about the planet. It's about carbon emissions. Yeah. It's about green. It's about energy, energy, energy. And that's a topic, you know, that is very serious. So when we started to think about 5G products, and you mentioned just now everything's about latency and mm-hmm. speed and massive connection, but one of the things we did embark on when we were trying to develop 5G is efficiency. So we can state, and today we announced that our product, the power consumption is almost the same as 5G, as 4G.
Yeah.
And it's 20 or 30 times the capacity, and it's, you know, lighter, 25 kilos, and broader spectrum. So it's going to save on installation. You know, all of those things contribute to carbon, carbon, carbon. But directly, if you were to deploy 5G networks over 4 and 3G, you'll reduce the carbon footprint of mobile networks globally. That's a good reason to deploy it. But what about the downstream effects, right? Mm-hmm. So if you were to put in these more energy-saving solutions, then downstream industries consume less, which means you don't have to dig up oil and, you know, dig up coal or mine oil and all this, however you extract it, I'm not an expert. But you know, you don't need oil and coal based, you don't need fossil fuel based things. Yeah. You can start to consume less. If you consume less, you need to generate less. And then you give the planet a chance to perhaps heal.
And I think it's a good view to think about if you start investing in 5G as well.
It is. And you know, so we can do so many things. We can have platforms like the 5G Innovation Center that we have here, Experience Center, where we're going to invite partners and people to come in with their great ideas and crazy ideas. Mm-hmm. And we're going to put a platform in to show them what could be possible so that then they can use all their creativity to try and say, hey, we could fix this industry sector or that industry sector, or we can provide these social values. You know, the biggest challenge we have after energy and the carbon footprint of the planet is really about health. Just take the coronavirus. You know, if we had the analytics, if everything was connected, we would have had all the data, we'd have known exactly what to do, if you understand my meaning.
Okay. Much faster.
Well, you know, China's doing a good job. You imagine trying to contain things in a population of 11 million, in just one city and everybody traveling, you know, hundreds of million people traveling home on holidays and things. Of course, it's a big challenge, right? So, but just imagine the power of connectivity and virtual consultations and things like this, and connected ambulances, and not necessarily robotic surgery, but telemedicine, right? Those sorts of things. They're huge contributors to aging populations, to developing populations, developing countries where health, malnutrition, poverty, you know, simple diseases that we take for granted are still challenges. You know, we could fix those things. And 5G, IoT, cloud and AI, those things all sort of come together. If we did those things, we would make a huge contribution in this area.
Paul, thanks a lot for this type of breakthrough views, I think, on 5G. And thank you for watching here from London, from Huawei Product and Solution Launch event. Thank you. Enjoy this video? Don't forget to like, subscribe, share, and get notifications of my new video.